Welcome back, Daily Caller. I'm Christian Daytuck, your senior White House correspondent. I'm lucky enough today to sit down with Republican National Committee Chairwoman Ronna McDaniel, who I'm sure most of you guys knew had to quarantine herself over some of the coronavirus fears, but she's taking time to speak with us today. And Ronna, I'm very appreciative, and I'm glad to see you're looking healthy, and I hope you're feeling healthy also.
Well, thanks for having me, Christian. Yes, it was challenging to quarantine not just myself, but my kids. My 15-year-old son had his birthday during that process. He was pretty unhappy, but I'm glad we did. We're seeing a spike in my state of Michigan. Our family's on the mend. But I really do feel for people in that situation. It was hard to get groceries. It was hard to get out. Obviously, we couldn't go to the store. Luckily, we had a lot of neighbors bring soup and just drop it by our door and not ring the doorbell and text us and say there's a treat for you on the front porch.
Well, I'm glad that they were taking care of y'all via the proper social distancing guidelines. That's super important. And obviously, the president just extended that for another month. One of the sort of overriding narratives in the media right now is President Trump's relationships with some of these governors. And obviously, like with Andrew Cuomo and Gavin Newsom, who both of which are not traditionally considered allies of President Trump, they're working hand in hand. And then some of the other governors like Jay Inslee and your home state's governor, Gretchen Whitmer, are having a little bit more of an adversarial relationship. What do you make of what's going on between Whitmer and Trump these days? Because she appears to have walked back a little bit some of her critiques from over the weekend.
Yeah, well, certainly the president's working with every state and he cares about every American, regardless of relationships with specific governors. And the governors who've been the most critical are people who ran for president or who are auditioning for vice president, as my governor Gretchen Whitmer is doing. So she's been overly critical, I think, very unfairly to the president. She spread around our state over the weekend that the president, in a punitive way, was trying to hurt Michigan and telling vendors not to work with our state. That just is so untrue. I think that's hurtful for the whole country to have that type of rhetoric out there. In fact, yesterday he announced that Michigan's getting 400 ventilators on top of the 100,000 N95 masks. But the president has said, I'll work with anybody. He's bringing in the private sector. He doesn't care if you're a Democrat or Republican. This is an all hands on deck natural disaster that's hit our whole globe. Of course, it's affecting supply chains. Of course, it's affecting things that we never anticipated, like the amount of ventilators and the masks that we need. So the president has done everything he can to engage the private sector. And you're seeing, just yesterday, he announced we're at 1 million tests. We now can conduct 100,000 a day. And on issue after issue, the president's finding ways to solve problems, along with governors and local authorities.
Speaking of solving problems, the longer coronavirus lasts, the more it's going to impact the campaign. And I think if anyone is built to benefit from that, it's probably President Trump with his massive online following. I think it's going to be a little different for some of these down ballot Republicans, though. How are you guys in some of these local campaigns sort of shifting strategies to deal with not being able to go out and hold rallies and meet people face to face?
Well, certainly the RNC benefited by being on the ground early, which traditionally a campaign is not on the ground as early as we were. And now we're seeing the wisdom of that. We were raising money at a record pace and we were already in 23 states with staff on the ground. So everything's gone virtual now. We're holding Zoom meetings. We're doing trainings. We contacted 1.5 million voters just last weekend, which is more than we did in a week in September heading into an election in 2018. So that is just an astronomical number of contacts with voters. Of course, everyone's home, so we're able to reach them. And really right now, we're talking about the things that the administration's doing, giving resources to help with coronavirus. One of our volunteers called a woman who couldn't get out of her home. Her husband's a veteran with Parkinson's. He ended up buying her groceries. Now they're friends. They talk on the phone. She happened to change her registration from Democrat to Republican during that process. But those are the things that we're doing across the country. And our digital presence is allowing us to raise money as well in preparation for when we do come out of this time. And we are in a campaign because we do need to reelect this president and candidates up and down the ticket.
You just touched on the digital campaign, and obviously the RNC and President Trump's campaign have put up absolutely astronomical fundraising numbers this cycle, even bigger than they did in 2016. How is fundraising being impacted by coronavirus? Obviously, you want to, you know, be, I guess, sensitive to the peril that the country is facing. So you don't want to hit that super hard. But are, have you guys seen a dip in numbers? Is it about the same, or has it even been a boost in some aspects?
Well, on the major fundraising where we had events, where we had the first lady or the president doing events, those are all gone because you can't have those types of events. But the digital with the small dollar fundraising, we're continuing to do that. I mean, I think a lot of Americans recognize we have an election coming up. It's coming up in November. We certainly don't want to put people in any difficult situation. But if they want to see this president reelected, they want to see us maintain the Senate. They want to see us win back the House. So we feel like fundraising's strong even through this. Obviously, there's been a little bit of a dip. But we know that the election's around the corner. There's some special elections coming up in Wisconsin and California. So those are things that we're dialing into as well.
Speaking of winning back the House, how are you guys feeling about that? I know it's basically going to be a toss-up, and then there is the idea that Republicans could even pick up a larger majority in the Senate. How are you guys feeling heading into November, coronavirus aside?
Yeah, I mean, the Senate, we have a big map of Republicans that are up, and there's some at-risk seats in Colorado and Arizona. There's pickup opportunities in states like Alabama and my state of Michigan with John James. We have to maintain our control of the Senate, and that's why having this apparatus in place so early in the 23 states has been so important. On the House side, you know, we got to pick up some seats in California. This special will be important. We need 18 seats to flip back the House because of Van Drew coming over to the Republican Party. But the recruitment's been very strong. Kevin McCarthy's done a great job recruiting candidates on the House side. I feel good. Of course, the whole country's not paying attention to campaigns right now. And so it'll be nice to come out and focus on winning back the House, especially when you see Nancy Pelosi delay the CARE Act to put in this wish list of election reforms and things that had nothing to do with coronavirus. I think that just comes home to voters as to why we do need a change in the House leadership. Because I think what she's done is really shameful. While she was focusing on impeachment in January, the president was taking decisive action with China. And you see on issue after issue, the Democrats have really been out of step and very partisan through this whole process.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought up Pelosi because it's, you know, Congress doesn't always have a great approval rating. But throughout the coronavirus relief effort, the polling indicates that people are fed up with the partisanship in Congress. I'm curious, because based on the news that we're going to have a phase four stimulus coming down the pipe, do you think there's anything else that Congress needs to put in there that the American public really needs these days? Or is the Trump administration and Secretary Steve Mnuchin basically got a good grasp of what we need to do to mitigate some of these economic effects from fighting the pandemic?
Well, I think what Nancy Pelosi just tried to do with the CARE Act, I think a lot of Americans are very wary as she was putting in election reforms or dictating corporate board diversity, things that had nothing to do with the crisis we were in. So with stage four, obviously it's got to be bipartisan. We've got to be looking at what are the implications of the virus specifically, and not having Democrats add this wish list of how they want to govern. You know, Rahm Emanuel famously said, never let a crisis go to waste. And we've seen Democrat governors even across the country try and make election reforms through this crisis. And we've got to fight that, because that's not what this virus is about. Let's do the things that help the American people. Let's not use this to create a legislative wish list.
I got one more question for you, and then I'm going to let you get out of here because I know you are super busy. I know you're still working from home. I'm not sure if you've been following this narrative, but there's sort of a groundswell movement which is urging New York Governor Andrew Cuomo to sort of throw his hat into the ring at a possible brokered convention. He said last night on CNN that he's not considering it, but are you guys entertaining this possibility at all? I mean, I think one of the reasons why he's so popular right now is because he's both being a little bit combative with the president, but giving him credit where credit is due. It's an interesting about face from a state which definitely has not been friendly to the president since he entered office.
Well, it speaks volume about Joe Biden. I mean, he's doing these coronavirus briefings from his library at home, and he's falling flat on his face, oftentimes reading talking points really behind what the president's already doing, urging the president to engage the Defense Production Act while the president's already done that. So really out of step. I think more than anything, it's a reflection on their weak front runner, their weak presumptive nominee. I think Cuomo was honest yesterday when he said, I'm not running for president. But you've seen an enthusiasm gap for Biden. You've seen him be eclipsed through this process, holding these pseudo briefings. And I think the Democrats are concerned about their nominee.
Yeah, I would agree with you 100% on that one. Well, anyway, Ronna, thank you very much for speaking with us today. I'm looking forward to continuing this conversation in the future and seeing you back in D.C. when all of this madness ends.
I'm looking forward to it. Stay safe, and thank you so much for having me, Christian.
And to all of our viewers out there, you stay safe too. Click subscribe if you haven't done so already. Click the bell to get notified every time one of these videos goes live. I'm Christian Daytalk. We will see you next time.